Hello everyone, welcome back to my channel Dentistry Made Easy. So the topic for today is direct retainers from removal partial dentures from prosthodontics. And I have described about the components of removal partial dentures in the video of introduction to removal partial denture. And if you haven't watched that video, then I'm linking that in the description down. So basically, what is direct retainer? It is applied to the abutment teeth for the purpose of holding a removal partial dentures. According to the definition of glossary of prosthodontic, it is termed as it is the component part of the removal partial denture that is used to retain and prevent dislodgement consisting of the clasp assembly or precision attachment. So now basically, what are your abutment? Abutment are the teeth which are present adjacent to your edentulous space. This is your edentulous space and these are the abutment. They are the natural present teeth. And these are the direct retainers. They engage your abutment teeth and they help to hold your RPD. Now, what is retention? Retention is nothing but it resists the force of gravity, the adhesiveness of the food and the forces associated with the opening of the jaw. When you're opening your jaw or when some material, food material that sticks onto your clasp, so that time what happens is this direct retainer, it prevents it from dislodgement. It prevents from, it actually helps them to retain over there. So basically, these are the direct retainers and it helps to prevent the dislodgement because of all those different factors that can be gravity or adhesiveness and your forces which are associated with the opening of the jaws. Moving on towards the classification. Classification is basically direct retainers are extracoronal, that is outside your crown, and intracoronal, inside the crown. So extracoronal are manufactured retainers and custom made. They are again divided into two types. Then custom made are divided into two types, occlusally approaching and gingivally approaching. Occlusally approaching are the circumferential one, embrasure, onlay, half and half, grassos, and continuous clasp. And circumferential, they are again divided into further subtypes that are simple circlet, reverse circlet, multiple circlet, ring, fish hook, and combination clasp. And gingivally approaching are the bar clasp, T clasp, modified T clasp, Y clasp, I clasp, then infra bulge clasp, and I bar. Then this intracoronal attachments, these are the intracoronal attachments, so they are divided into internal, external, stud, bar, and special. So in short, direct retainers are intracoronal and extracoronal. Intracoronal, they are nothing but the attachments, as these different attachments, and extracoronals are again attachments and clasps. Clasps are mainly this circumferential and bar, and in circumferential there is cast circumferential and combination, as I have shown you over here. So basically, this is brief about your classification. I'm going to cover each one of this in this video. Now in 1916, Prothero, he proposed the cone theory to explain the basis for clasp retention. So according to this theory, he stated that the shape of the crown of posterior teeth, it should be equivalent to two cones, that is upper and lower, and it should share a common base. So your upper one is your occlusal and the lower one is the cervical. So I'll show you how it sits. So over here, this is your upper cone and this is your lower cone. And it shares a common base, that is this line over here. Suppose this is the line which shares the common base. And the part of the clasp that ends on the cervical cone would resist movement in the occlusal direction. For example, if your clasp, it engages in the cervical portion, then what does happens is, it resists the movement in the occlusal direction. If it is coming cervically, then it resists the movement in occlusal direction. And it, because what happens is, it is forced to deform to come out to from the undercut. Now it has engaged the undercut, so it has to deform to come out of that undercut. And the degree of resistance to deformation determines the clasp retention. So how retentive it is, like the retention to deformation, it determines your clasp retention. So this is the Prothero's cone theory. According to Prothero's cone theory, the tooth is considered a pair of cone sharing a base. It is a pair of cone sharing a base. Hence, the height of contour is considered as the base of the cone and all your retentive component should cross the height of contour. Now, this is your base and base is nothing but your height of contour. So that is the most bulged area of the tooth. Moving on towards the parts of clasp. So the parts of clasp, they can be rigid or flexible. The flexible components, they are designed below the height of contour. So basically your flexible components, whichever the flexible components are, they are designed. Suppose this is your height of contour over here. So they are designed below the height of contour, and so that they can engage the undercut. At the same time, they can flex and pass through the height of contour without requiring much effort. In a conventional, the tip of the retentive arm is the only flexible component. So now over here, this is your retentive arm. So retentive arm is divided into retentive terminal and your retentive arm. So retentive terminal is the only flexible component of your clasp. Rest all are rigid ones. Hence, all other are placed above the height of contour, and only your retentive terminal, it should be below the height of contour. So moving on towards the first component, that is the retentive arm. So retentive arm, it engages the undercut on the abutment, and it is designed to retain the denture. So there are two parts of it. That is the retentive arm and your retentive terminal. Retentive terminal is the flexible and retentive arm is the rigid one. And retentive terminal, it engages the undercut and it is below the height of contour. And your retentive arm is above the height of contour. Then the reciprocal arm. Reciprocal arm is nothing but it is used to oppose the action of some other parts of the prosthesis. So over here, this is your reciprocal arm. So the functions of reciprocal arm is reciprocation against the action of retentive terminal. So suppose there is more pressure on towards your retentive arm. So what happens is it moves towards that side. So your reciprocal arm, it resists that movement. It stabilizes the horizontal against the horizontal forces, and it contributes also to the vertical support and the indirect retention. And it should be rigid and it should not taper. It should be positioned on the tooth surface reasonably parallel to the denture's path of insertion. It should be parallel to the denture's path of insertion. Then the next part is your shoulder. So shoulder is nothing but it connects the body to the clasp terminal. It also provides some stabilization. So shoulder is this part. It connects your body. It connects your body to the clasp terminal. So this is your clasp terminal, and it like attaches it. It connects them both. And it also helps to stabilize against the horizontal forces. Now the next part is the rest. Rest, it provides vertical support, or it prevents the tissueward movements of the prosthesis. So this is your rest. Rest is, it provides vertical support and it prevents tissueward movements of the prosthesis. It ensures that the retentive tip of the clasp remains in the planned depth of the undercut. So rest is nothing but it prevents the tissueward movements. And the last part is your minor connector. Minor connectors are, again, they helps to connect different components to the major connector. So these are the components of the clasp. So this is your reciprocal arm, shoulder, retentive arm, retentive terminal, rest, and body, and minor connector. This part, it helps you to connect to the major connector. So over here, this is again, all are the components of the clasp assembly. And the reciprocal arm, it should be positioned above the height of contour. As I said, only the flexible component, that is the retentive terminal, is below the height of contour. Now, what are the requirements of direct retainer? So the clasp assembly, it should meet the following requirements. The following requirements are, the first one is support. So support is nothing but the resistance to displacement of the prosthesis towards the basal tissue or the underlying structures, and it is provided by the rest. So it is nothing but the resistance to the gingival displacement. So it should have proper support. Then the next, and it is provided by the rest. Next is your reciprocation. Reciprocation is nothing but the mechanism by which the lateral forces are generated by the retentive arm passing over a height of contour, and it is counterbalanced by the reciprocal arm. As I said, in the parts of components of the clasp, there is that retentive arm and reciprocal arm. So reciprocal arm, it counterbalances the retentive arm. And the next component, so reciprocation is nothing but the resistance to the orthodontic movement of the tooth using the reciprocal arm or the elements which are placed against the guiding plane. During placement and removal of the partial dentures, the retentive arm, they flex over the height of contour and generates energy. At this point, the rigid reciprocal arm should contact the plane and it should prevent the orthodontic movement from taking place. Then the next one is your stability. Stability is the quality of the prosthesis to be firm, stable, constant, and to resist displacement by the functional, horizontal, or rotational stresses. So it is resistance to the lateral movements, and it is done by your reciprocal arm and the minor connectors. Then the next one is the retention. Retention is your retentive arm, it should be located in the undercuts on the abutment. So retention is nothing but the quality which is inherent in the dentures that resists the vertical forces or of dislodgement. For example, as I said in the definition, there are the forces of gravity, adhesiveness of the food, or the forces which are associated with the opening of the jaws. So it should resist that. And the main function is this only, the direct retention, as the name says. So it is the most important function of the clasp, is to provide retention to the prosthesis. And the retentive arm of the clasp assembly, it provides your retention. The next is your encirclement. So encirclement of greater than 180 degree of the 180 degree of the tooth, it prevents the prosthesis from moving away from the tooth. So over here in this diagram, as you can see, this clasp, it has encircled in 180 degree, and it helps it because of this. What happens is it prevents the prosthesis from moving away from the tooth. It has good support all over. It has good, like it has engaged properly all over the tooth. Then the next one is passivity. It is the quality or the condition of inactivity or rest assumed by the teeth, tissue and denture when the removal partial prosthesis is in place but not under masticatory pressure. So over here, suppose you're like, it is at rest, a direct retainer should should not exert force against the tooth. So when there is no masticatory force but your denture is placed into the mouth, so it should like completely, it should do all these requirements. So over here, the retention is the resistance to the movement of the denture against the path of insertion. Support is the resistance to the movement of the denture towards the path of insertion, and support is provided by the rest. Then reciprocation is essential to stabilize the tooth against the deleterious effects of the retentive arm. So these are the requirements of your direct retainers. Moving on towards the clasp circumferential, the different types of your clasp. So first one is clasp circumferential clasp. So a retainer that encircles a tooth by more than 180 degree, including the opposite angles, and which generally contacts the tooth throughout the extent of the clasp with at least one terminal which is located in an undercut, is known as your clasp circumferential clasp. So it is introduced by Nisbet in 1916. And it is the most simple and versatile clasp. It is a clasp of choice in tooth bone cases. Then it clasp assembly, it should have one retentive arm which is opposed by the reciprocal arm, and it is originating from the rest, as we have seen in the components of the clasp. And this clasp circumferential clasp is also known as Akis clasp. Then they embrace more than half of the tooth, like they encircle it properly in 180 degree, like over here you can see the circle encircles the tooth. Then all the components of the clasp assembly, they are made up of cast alloys. So this is made up of cast, and hence it is known as cast circumferential. Circumferential is nothing but it circumference, like it encircles the tooth, so it is named like that. Then retentive terminal, it should originate above the height of contour and the terminate below them. Then the retentive terminal, it should point towards the occlusal surface, never towards the gingival. So your retentive terminal, it should point towards the occlusal, but it shouldn't point to the gingival surface. And the retentive tip, it should only terminate in mesial or distal line angles. Then what are the advantages of cast? Cast circumferential clasp, they are easiest clasp to make and repair. There is less food retention. They are best when applied in the tooth supported partial dentures. Then they derive excellent support and retention, and they are used in most of the situations. Then the next, then the disadvantages of this are it covers last tooth, it covers more of the tooth surface area, as it is covering, like you can see, more than half of the tooth. Then it is difficult to adjust with the pliers, normal pliers. If the clasp are placed high on the tooth, width of the foot table, it increases, leading to the generation of greater occlusal forces, and it cannot be used for cases with an undercut away from the dentular spaces. So this is the most common use clasp. Now these are the various type of cast circumferential clasp. So first one is simple circlet clasp, reverse circlet and multiple circlet. So in some simple circlet, it is the most widely used ones, and it is best for tooth supported partial dentures. It approaches the undercut from the edentulous space. It engages the undercut which is located away from the edentulous space, and it should be adjusted only in one direction, that is buccolingually, but it shouldn't be like adjusted in occlusal gingival direction, and they cannot be used for distal extension cases. Distal extension cases are nothing but the Kennedy's class 1 and class 2. Then the next one is your reverse circulate. Reverse circulate is the class which is used when the retentive undercut on the abutment teeth is located adjacent to your abutment space, located adjacent to your edentulous space. So this is your reverse circulate. Over here, as you can see, this is your simple circulate. In simple circulate, it is used when your edentulous space is away from the undercut. And over here, your undercut, it is adjacent to your edentulous space. So here we are using reverse circulate. Then, and it can be used in distal extension cases. Then the multiple circulate is, it is a combination of two opposing simple circulate class, which is joined at the terminal end of the reciprocal arm. Then it is used in periodontally compromised abutment teeth in distal extension situations. So it is like two simple circulate, they are joined at the reciprocal, at the end of your reciprocal arm. So this is your reciprocal arm. This is your retentive arm. This is your rest. Then they are joined at your, at the end of your reciprocal arm. So this is your multiple circulate, which is used in periodontically weak teeth abutments, when your abutment are periodontically weak. Now the other ones are the embrasure class. So it is the combination of two simple circulate, which is joined at your body. Now in your multiple circulate, the class, they were joined at the end of your terminal, at the end of your reciprocal arm. In this embrasure, they are connected, like they are joined at the body. It is used on the side of the arch where there is no edentulous space. It crosses the marginal ridges of the two teeth to form a double occlusal rest. So now you can see over here, it forms double occlusal rest. As you can see over here, it forms double occlusal rest, and it is used in Kennedy's class 2 and class 3 without any modifications. And to know the Kennedy's classification, I even have explained them well in the introduction to removal partial dentures. I have explained about all the Kennedy's classification and the modifications to it. And the next one is your ring clasp. Ring clasp is when you're considering your distal edentulous condition with distolingual in undercut. When you have a distolingual undercut and it is a distal edentulous condition where a reverse circulate clasp cannot be placed because there is no buccal undercut, in such situations your ring clasps are used, and they are also used in cases with lingually tipped molar abutments. The disadvantages are nothing but they cause alteration in the food flow pattern. It cannot retain its physical quality. It is difficult to adjust. And the contraindications of the ring clasp is if the buccinator attachment, it lies close to the molar. If your buccinator is lying close to your lower molar, so at that time your ring clasp cannot be used. Now the next one is your hairpin clasp. So this is your hairpin clasp, or it is also known as fish hook or reverse action clasp. So it is a type of simple circulate clasp which, after crossing the facial surface of the tooth, it loops back. So it loops back to engage the proximal undercut. When there is a proximal undercut, so over here this loops back to engage that undercut. Then it is used in conditions where the undercut is near the edentulous space. The indications are when the undercut is adjacent to your edentulous area and if there is presence of soft tissue undercut. Then next one is your onlay clasp. Onlay clasp, it is the extension of the metal crown or the onlay with the buccal and lingual clasp arms. So over here, as you can see, this is your onlay clasp. And the next one is your combination clasp. Combination clasp is a clasp, circumferential clasp, cannot be used when an undercut is adjacent to the edentulous space. So it is used only when your cast circumferential is only used when your edentulous space is away from the undercut. So as to provide a destructive rotatory forces on the distal abutment, in such cases, a flexible wrought wire retentive arm is used to replace the rigid cast alloy. So as we have seen in cast circumferential, all the components, they are made up of cast. So in combination, what happens is your retentive terminal is made up of wrought. Wrought as it is more flexible. So the retentive arm, so your retentive arm is made up of wrought wire and the rest of is made up of cast. So hence it is known as combination clasp. and it has a greater flexibility when it is placed into a deeper undercut. And it is used in maxillary canines and premolar due to its superior aesthetics, and it appears more aesthetically pleasing, and hence it can be used in anterior teeth too. Moving on towards the last part, that is the bar class. The bar class is a caste class that arises from the partial denture framework, and it approaches the retentive undercut from the gingival direction. So now your bar class, it approaches the retentive undercut from the gingival direction, whereas your caste circumferential, they arises from the occlusal direction. And it is opposed to the caste circumferential that approaches the undercut from the occlusal direction. Then the retentive clasp are identified by the shape of the retentive terminal. So there are various retentive terminals. There are T, Y, L, I, U, and S. The shape is unimportant as long as the direct retina is mechanically and functionally stable. It covers minimal tooth structures with minimal display. The eye bar most often meets this requirement. So as we have seen in caste circumferential, it encircles the tooth. So it is covering more of the tooth. Whereas bar class, there is minimal tooth structure which is covered. Then the T and Y shaped terminal ends are the most misused class. The full coverage of the T and Y terminal is rarely necessary for adequate retention. Now, what are the contraindications of bar class? So when there are deep cervical undercuts, bar class cannot be used. When there is severe soft tissue or bony undercuts, if there is insufficient vestibular depth, then if there is pronounced frenal attachment. So over there, bar class cannot be used, and it cannot be used in tilted, if there are tilted abutments, if there is soft tissue undercuts and there is shallow vestibule. So over there, this class cannot be used. So basically, this is your bar class. This is a Y type of bar class, and it approaches from gingival portion. Now you can see over here, it is approaching from gingival portion. And as you have seen in caste circumferential, they approaches from the occlusal surface. Like as you can see over there, there was this rest portion which was resting on the abutments. Then there was this retentive arm, your reciprocal arm. And in this, they are approaching gingivally. The types of the bar clasp are T clasp, modified T clasp, Y clasp, I clasp, then I bar. So T clasp is used when there is distal extension. So this is nothing, T is because it forms T, letter T. So it is used in distal extension cases, and it can be used for a tooth supported partial dentures with natural undercuts. Then it should not be used over a soft tissue undercut. In modified T clasp, what happens is, it is similar to the T clasp, but the non-retentive finger, usually the mesial terminal of the T terminal, is removed. It is used in canine. So what happens, to make it more aesthetically pleasing, we cut off one portion of this T. So over here, as you can see, there are like proper T. In this, we have removed this portion, and mostly we are removing this from the mesial side. So it appears more aesthetically pleasing. So this is your modified T, and the disadvantage is it does not have a 180 degree encirclement. Then the Y clasp. Y clasp is basically a T clasp, but it is modified to suit certain abutments where the height of contour is high. So these are nothing but your Y. So Y is basically again like your T only, but when your height of contour is high, at that time we are modifying it as Y clasp. Then your I clasp. This is your I clasp as a I, letter I. So I clasp, it is used on the distobuccal surface of the canine for aesthetics. Now for aesthetics, we are using this I as it is most aesthetically pleasing clasp. Then only the tip of the clasp, it should contact the tooth. Hence the stability and encirclement is decreased, as only the tip is touching the abutment to make it more aesthetically pleasing. So because of that, what happens is your stability and encirclement is decreased. So this is your T clasp, L, C, I, U, S. So these are various like clasps which have their indications and contraindications. And part is the difference between circumferential and the bar clasp. And this is a very common question which is asked like as a short answer question. Circumferential clasp, it approaches the undercut from the occlusal aspect. As I said, it like approaches the undercut, it arises from the occlusal aspect, whereas the bar clasp, it arises from the gingival aspect. Then it arises above the height of contour. So as you have seen over there in the different cast circumferential glass, it was above the height of contour. But in bar glass, as it is approaching gingivally, it is usually arising below the height of contour. Then it has a rigid minor connector. It has a flexible minor connector. The minor connector for the bar glass is called as approach arm. Then it is easier to remove, like cast circumferential glass, they're easier to remove. This is because only the retentive terminal should flex to be relieved from the, so only your retentive terminal is engaging your undercut, and only that portion has to be flexed when you're removing it. But it, as compared to the circumferential, bar glass are easier to set, but they're difficult to remove because the minor connector should flex along with the retentive term to be relieved from the undercut. Over here, even your minor connector, it is engaging the undercut, and hence it is difficult to remove. Then it has a pull type of retention. There is a retentive tip. It should pull occlusally to engage the undercut. It has a push type of retention. That is the retentive tip. It should push occlusively to engage the undercut. Due to the continuous tooth support, it has good brazing effect. Due to limited, like there is limited contact. So it has less brazing effect. Then it is less aesthetic. Due to more exposure, it is more aesthetic. Then it has reduced foot debris accumulation, and as it adapts more closely to the tooth, there is more foot debris accumulation in bar glass because a space they exist between the minor connector and the abutment surface. Then it is easier to repair because of its simple design. It is difficult to repair. It increases the width of occlusal table because the retentive arm, it arises near the occlusal surface. There is no such problem as it is located in the lower portion. There is, due to increased tooth coverage, it may cause decalcification of the tooth. As more of the tooth is covered, it can cause decalcification, and over here there is no decalcification, and it can be used in tilted abutment. But as we have seen, the contraindication for bar glass, they cannot be used in tilted abutments and soft tissue undercut, whereas your circumferential can be used in such cases. So this is the like overview of your direct retainers, like which direct retainers are used in which conditions, and there are mostly circumferential glass which are used, and bar glass are used when we have to make it more aesthetically pleasant. So this was it of this video. I hope you find this video helpful, and if you did, then please like, comment down if you need any topics to be done like prior to what I have scheduled, and do share it with your friends, and do subscribe to my channel, as I'm coming up with many more like this to make things simple for you. And I have combined 2 to 3 textbooks in this, so this are the like whole set of your notes for this topic. So this was it of this video. Thank you so much.